star.
There was such an omnipresent of really tepid dance music with the same terrible clothes, but fake notions of freedom through dancing. We wanted to be a technical, a vision of the Sex Pistols or Public Enemy.
10 o'clock, and our view is it's going to be a hung parliament. This election is too close to call.
James lived about 5 doors down from Neil Kinnock's constituency house, wasn't it?
Yeah, it did, yeah, yeah. He was up number 28. So we felt really close to the general election results, even more so.
So the mood here is one of almost tangible tension.
In the run-up, Labour had really good poll numbers, so there was a sense of optimism.
And it was so dispiriting seeing the results coming in. I felt kind of personally attached. The miners' strike in 1984 had a massive impact on us growing up. You could see a lot of ex-miners without work, trying to retrain. It was tough times. There was just a rage. That's what we were obsessed with, harnessing a working class rage. Most people were having a really good time at that point, felt like to us, which was, you know, the opposite of what we wanted to express. Which meant we were going to be completely on our own, but we enjoyed being hated as much as we were loved.
We'd rather be sensationalised than just be another AME band and get easy critical respect.
Yeah, critical respect's the easiest thing to get in the world because journalists are so crap.
I think early doors, our philosophy was a mixture of socialism and nihilism and narcissism. We wanted to transfer ourselves to something much more glamorous and exciting. You know, it was great walking up the high street with eyeliner and your mum's blouse on.
So we don't aspire to doing millions of concerts. I'd rather never have to do 50 in my whole life.
There's no glory in the, like, legendary toilets of Britain, you know. I'd just rather go straight to the big venues instead.
We wanted to get right round the world as quick as possible. The plan was to be on the cover of The Enemy and get on a playlist on Radio 1, and then the apex was to get on Top of the Pops.
Now the band One Music Paper called the most articulate and furious band in the world. Judge for yourself.
When we got the call, I might have even hugged Richie, which is not something that we put particularly that touchy-feely.
We're not good at hugs.
First Top of the Pops, Will You Love Us. James was bare chest, Will You Love Us, scrawled in lipstick.
How'd it come about?
Well,
I made it.
Nick and Richie said, you gotta go bare top. I remember looking at myself in the mirror in the dressing room. You know, I can make myself look thinner, so I turned the waistband in on my jeans, I think.
White jeans, we all had white jeans on.
Yeah, yeah. Remember, you're being careful where you sit in at all times, not staying away from chocolate.
Remember, we purposely got a bubble machine. We convinced ourselves it was a subversive act, but in reality, it was just like being anti everything else. It's like you wouldn't get any credible bands doing this, so let's do it.
I remember just Nick stomping around the place and coming really close to me and everything. I was like, whoa,
I tried to do Mick Ronson, David Bowie, and I tried to mouth your guitar strings.
Yes, yes, he did, yes. And I was going, geez, you just lost him, my God.
be fair. As a front man, he's really, like, dare I say it, rather sexy. I remember having a little jump towards the end, you know, thinking, where's that coming from?
Yeah! Not much health and safety going on. The one thing I remember was a praying guy who would be there with a cigarette going, all right, when do I press this button?
Well, we didn't ask for the pyros, but they just sort of explode. Doesn't seem to have that much rhyme or reason to it. It was a beautiful moment, I must admit. It did feel really vindicating.
And then not so long after, we were on the jukebox in either Coronation Street or in
EastEnders.
Yeah.
The Holy Grail.
In the Old Vic, and my mum was just like, that's it, you've done it, son.